tell you that. Brooklyn's Radio.
She was wearing nothing at all. Enough to make the eyes that's in the back of your head wish that they had not been facing the wall. Girls, and it concerns you what it's doing to me. Having you a heart and your soul. I don't want your sympathy. I wanna know. I wanna know. Say that on the weekend if it's okay with. I'd like to visit one or two of your friends. There's this big reunion happens every year. The only thing is that they don't allow men. Do you take me for a fool? Is that what you think? Is this your idea of a joke? Don't know what you're up to, but whatever it is, I wanna know. I wanna know. It was never.
Hi, this is Gilbert O'Sullivan, and you're listening to Suzanne's World of Arts and Entertainment.
Yes, that's my first guest there, and whose song kicks off tonight with I Wanna Know from the album Gilbertville. And if you want to know everything about Gilbert O'Sullivan and where he'll be appearing, well, keep listening. Hello and welcome to the Arts and Entertainment Show with me, Suzanne Hunter, and have I got a show for you tonight. So many fabulous guests, and we'll be hearing from Gilbert O'Sullivan in just a bit, along with a man who's been writing film scores since he was 19 years old, Sir Richard Rodney Bennett. And my final guest, for whom life is one big adventure, for the charming and cheeky Charlie Borman. Now, as for new material on the show, with 16 weeks in number one, who can deny this brilliant song airplay? All you Gilbert O'Sullivan fans, enjoy and keep listening, because we'll be hearing from the man himself in just a few moments.
Thank you. myself. I promised myself to treat myself and visit a nearby tower. And climbing to the top, will throw myself up in an effort to make clear to whoever what it's like when you're shattered, left standing in the lurch at a church where people were saying, "My God, that's tough." She stood him up. No point in us remaining. We may as well go. I did on my own, alone again, naturally. To think that only yesterday I was cheerful, bright and gay, looking forward to what wouldn't do the role I was about to play. But as if to knock me down, reality came around, and without so much as a mere touch, cut me into little about God in his mercy. If he really does exist, why did he desert me in my hour of need? I truly am indeed alone again, naturally. It seems to me that there are more hearts broken in the world that can't be mended, left unattended.
Now, it's a great delight to be speaking with Gilbert O'Sullivan.
Yes, hello, Suzanne.
Hi, nice to talk to you. Now, we're going to be talking about your exciting new album and the latest release in just a moment. But legions of fans will know your classics and number one hits. The likes of Claire, Get Down, Alone Again. Now, of course, every artist views their big hits a little bit differently. But how do you feel if your fans come to hear songs like Claire and Alone Again? Do you tire of singing them?
No, not at all. If I did, I wouldn't do it.
That's good.
No, we do a 2.5-hour concert, so there's every opportunity within that time frame to do all the well-known songs that people want to hear. Album tracks that very often people request, plus an opportunity to introduce some new songs. So it's a good mix.
Yes, let's talk about that again. Obviously, we won't harp on too long. But is it true that Alone Again was almost overlooked as a single?
It wasn't considered commercial. I mean, you could argue that a lot of my songs, even Nothing Rhymed, wasn't considered commercial. And so people kind of deliberated about whether it should be released. Good song, but maybe not commercial. Alone Again, it wasn't considered. I think there was another track off that album called Out of the Question, which was considered more commercial. But at the end of the day, the decision, people knew it was good, but it was that thing about whether it would get enough airplay. But it seemed to have worked out.
It certainly did, yes, understatement. Of course, a six-week chart topper by today's standard, you know, it's a rare thing. How did it feel at the time? Did it change your life in many ways?
Not really, no, because I'm not that kind of person to be taken in by that. I mean, we were number one in America, and to be honest, I'd rather have been number 20 in England, because that's where I lived. So I wasn't that impressed. I wasn't looking to be an international success. All I ever really wanted to be in terms of a good songwriter and making good records was to be a success in my own country, which was where I was brought up in England. So I wasn't kind of taken in by that. Nothing really changed because I tended to be the kind of person that spent a lot of time at home being a lyricist. As well as writing melodies and stuff, you need to have that kind of hermit-like existence to lock yourself away. So I didn't spend too much time traveling the world in those early days to get taken in by all the razzmatazz of the success that was going on. But I suffice to say, I enjoyed it. I mean, don't get me wrong. I mean, I was very happy that we were successful in all those places, but I wasn't taken in by the red carpet routine or whatever.
It's probably the best attitude to have, really, isn't it?
For me, I mean, again, I wouldn't knock people who enjoy that aspect of it, but I tended to keep my feet firmly on the ground because I knew that the key to everything I did was all down to the songwriting, and if I didn't have enough time to spend doing that, then I think I would have suffered.
Yes, it is. It's crucial to your well-being, isn't it? If that's where your heart is.
Yeah, that's the key to the artist in my case, anyway.
Absolutely. I mean, you've been quoted as believe that you write pop songs, and that's all you want to do, and you're not interested in just touring and living in the past. I mean, as you said, you can be taken in by the trappings, but you haven't. But where do you look for inspiration?
Just music. Just our love of music. I mean, I'm always searching for melodies. The kind of melodies you have to look for for inspiration and stuff. But lyrics, I think, it's in you. I think you're born with an ability to put words together and stuff. But it's the inspiration, I just enjoy music. I mean, I like a lot of the contemporary music. I think it's important to like what's going on today. I think there would be a danger if I didn't like anything that I heard on the radio. I think that it would be difficult to fit into a contemporary bracket if that was your view. But I actually like a lot of what's going on, so I can be inspired by that, production values. That's all very interesting.
Yes, there's always something you can take from other people's work,
absolutely.
Can't you?
Absolutely. You never stop learning, which is a good thing.
No, that's true. I mean, as you know, my show is called Suzanne Hunter's World of Arts and Entertainment, but your new album is called Gilbertville, and you've been to Nashville. Mm. But if Gilbertville was a place, what would it be? It was a place.
Yeah, if you've got the CD, you'll see inside the booklet is the actual photograph taken on the side of the road. My brother, who lives in Detroit, was driving through Ohio. Mm-hmm. And sure enough, he passed this road sign which said Gilbertville. And the double irony was that a little further on was a road sign for a place called Raymondville, which is my real name. So he took a picture, sent it to us, and it kind of linked the fact that we had recorded in Nashville. It kind of made sense to call the album that. So
perfect.
It worked out nicely.
Yeah, everybody has a place for them. And that sounds perfect, doesn't it? I mean, talking of expression and different worlds, one comedian who's created his own sort of crazy, surreal world features as an interlude speaking your poetry. I mean, many fans will be delighted to hear that you and comedian Harry Hill are on the same album. How did this collaboration come about?
Well, I'd worked with Harry about 4 or 5 years ago. I did a video, and I used Harry in that. So we've kind of remained friends since then. And I appeared on one of his TV shows as a payback. And I just had this idea. I always used to like with vinyl that the side one, and then you turn over the record to get side two. Whereas with CDs, of course, it just plays right through. So I just thought it would be nice to have a break in the middle of the CD, a little interlude. And I asked Harry if he would recite the poem. He does a nice job.
Yeah, certainly does. I mean, many people will, talking of poetry, they'll remember your top 10 hit, Nothing Rhymed. Seems quite apt, you know, for writing poetry. But is yours the sort of rhyming kind, or are you sort of, would you actually rhyming
kind? I don't consider myself a poet. I mean, I cringe when people talk about lyrics as being poetry. Mm. Poetry are not set to music. Lyrics need to be set to music. And that's what they are. They're good or they're bad or indifferent, but lyrics are all there are. I don't find lyrics as poetry, because I think, as I say, poetry is written without music and stuff. But I love the rhyming process. I mean, I've always enjoyed playing with words from my college days, writing the poem that's on the album that Harry, I mean, I did that in my college days because I was very influenced by Spike Milligan. I used to love Spike Milligan's use of words, nonsensical words. So he's remained an influence on me. And I just like playing with words. It's fascinating. And I think as a lyricist, you can incorporate things that are going on in the world today, as well as just writing straightforward love songs. But I don't feel limited by just writing pop songs. I still feel there's an awful lot I can learn. that I enjoy doing. I don't want to diverse into doing musicals, classical. I just like to stick to what I'm doing because I haven't found it boring. I mean, it's arguable that if I found writing songs boring and I needed to find a new challenge, then of course you could argue then would be the time to kind of move into other areas.
Yes, well, it's crucial for the soul, isn't it? As long as you're inspired still and the interest is there, then it really translates.
Yeah, that's all I need. It's writing pop songs for me is, you know, of course everybody seems to write songs these days, but it isn't that easy.
No, I can't imagine it would be.
No, it's an art form that I really love.
Oh, that's great. It's great to find something that you love. Mm. I mean, talking another guest, I had Dennis LeCorrier from Dr. Hook, published a book of poems. And, I mean, would you say it's a natural transition in a sense for a singer-songwriter?
Or to do what, sorry?
To move into poetry.
No, not necessarily, no. Because I think a songwriter, a lyricist moving into poetry will always be a lyricist. I think that... but I can't speak for other people. I mean, I just speak for myself. I'm sure that if that's what Dennis has done, good luck to him.
Yes, I mean, most writers of books write from personal experiences. Can the same be said of your songs through the years?
Not really, no. They're usually third party. I mean, most of my songs are not based on my experiences. I've written about lots of subjects which are not close to my heart, but I like to feel that I have an understanding of a subject. So if I'm talking about dark subjects, it's important that you have a sense of reality about it, that you have an understanding of what's going on in the song. You're not being flippant about it. You're not being lightweight about it. I don't think it's necessary to experience the things you write about. I think a good lyricist is somebody that can draw on other people's experiences or what people might be going through. I think that's what a good lyricist can do.
Definitely. I mean, you're renowned for your witty lyrics. How do you tend to go about finding those? Do they come to you when you're out walking or when you meet people?
Now, the lyrics generally happen with an empty notebook. Once I've established a melody that I want to put a lyric to, pretty much the melody will dictate the lyric. So so if it's a ballad-type melody, of course, that's what I'll get into. But the humor is there. I always like to feel there's an element of humor in my lyrics. And if you're sitting in a room from 9 to 5, 5 days a week, 4 weeks a month, at times it's helpful to have that little sense of humor.
Oh, definitely, yes. Definitely got to keep yourself in the right frame of mind there. I mean, talking of a sense of humor, but also having your own sort of style, there are very few singers that have as great a style as what you have. You have very two distinct looks over the years. You know, you set your trends. Where did the idea for the look of the flannel suits and then later the sweaters?
Yes, Chaplin. I used to hire... the catalyst for the look is the Beatles. When the Beatles came out in 62, they inspired a lot of young people like myself to write songs because they had no degrees, no A-levels to write songs. But they were doing as good as anybody. So that was an inspiration for us. So we all joined bands. I was a drummer in a band, and we used to do Beatles songs and Searchers songs. And then the look, the Beatles didn't have to look different, but they had Beatle haircuts, and they had collarless jackets, and that left a big impression on me. So by the time that I wanted to become a singer on my own, it was impossible really to do anything, look good, without keeping long hair. Long hair looked like it was here to stay. An image was a dirty word. So it meant that I had to go to the other extreme. So I created this kind of character, this Gilbert character, based on like a Just William thing. And I used to hire a Chaplin jacket from Berman's, the theatrical costumers. I just sort of worked on it, sort of one trouser leg shorter than the other, boots, football socks, turned up shirt. And the character of Gilbert. I just thought visually when you're sitting at a piano, it's pretty boring. You don't do much. You can't move around. So I just thought if I looked a bit odd, it would give people something to look at. So I was very proud of that image. I mean, in fact, ironically enough, because I had short back and sides, unlike everybody at the time, I actually look more fashionable now than a lot of people from the 70s.
Yeah, oh, that's fantastic. You've got to have a distinct look, I feel, don't you think?
Well, not. I think that most of the business would say no. I think that most people these days, images is non-existent. Everybody kind of looks normal.
Yes.
I think that those days are gone. But for me, it was very important. I was told by practically everybody who... in the business, drop the image. You'll be more successful if you grow your hair, wear a denim shirt and jeans, look like your audience. But I was determined, really adamantly determined, to look that different, and I stuck with it. So against all the odds and everybody, bar none, didn't like the way I looked. good for you. The only person who did was me.
Well, good for you. It's littered in history with people who have not taken advice for the better, I think.
There's no regrets, because I think had I compromised and done that, I might have sold more records. Mm. I might have had more credibility with an audience, critics or whatever. But I would have always regretted not sticking to my guns.
Absolutely, and that's what you live with ultimately, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, talking of style and another style icon, with Dean Martin's show, you appeared on that in the US. Was that a great experience?
Well, not really. It wasn't a pleasant. It wasn't a great experience.
Oh, really?
Because he was kind of an icon, because I knew him. We all grew up with Martin and Lewis and stuff. And so it was a major TV show. We were number one, and I went over. And I was doing a duet with him. And, of course, everybody was kind of in awe of him. But we did, 3 days rehearsals. And people like Gene Kelly were there, some very famous people. But he never turned up throughout the rehearsal. He was out playing golf. So the person who was playing him in the sketches that people like Gene Kelly were taking part in was his producer. So this enigma of Dean Martin being drunk and stuff, it's has nothing to do with drink. What happened was that he was turned up on the day of recording. And he hadn't a clue what he was saying. So he would be surrounded by idiot boards. So he'd be looking at these boards to tell him what he had to say. Everybody else knew their parts because they'd rehearsed. So he'd be sitting in a chair and there'd be people saying things to him. He'd be looking around to see where the board was that could tell him what he was saying, which people kind of identified as being a little bit, not being, but drunk or something, drinking. So that was that myth. And then my duet with him, he didn't really look at me, and we sang a little bit of Gentle on My Mind. So he wasn't that friendly. He kind of the kind of person who shakes hands with you and looks the other way and stuff. So I wasn't that impressed, a bit disappointed. But
ironically enough, they
sent me a DVD of the film of that, because obviously he died, but his daughter owns her father's estate. So I actually have a copy of me singing the song with him.
Yeah, and I bet it looked great after all that. It's often sometimes the experience and the story behind it belies the actual event, doesn't it? But
Of course Dean Martin was a wonderful actor, wonderful singer, and a great performer. But my experience was I was a little disappointed, because you're kind of in awe of people, and all you want them to be is a little bit friendly.
Absolutely, yes. Well, so you've done acting yourself, haven't you? You've done a little bit yourself as well, haven't you?
Well, only not really. We took a play on the road in 1990. Kind of every song had its play, kind of a musical, The Rise and Fall and Rise of a Singer. I mean, I did that with six actors. It was a way of doing a concert with a difference and stuff. So I acted a tiny little bit in that.
Now, of course, you obviously, when you're out on the road, you must meet lots and lots of fans, and you've got a great fan gallery on your website. Can you cite any unusual fan encounters over the years? Has any fan tried to get your attention in an unusual way?
No, the only kind of surprising thing is sometimes they turn up dressed in the old outfit and stuff. These are perhaps people who are in their 50s. It's strange to see a nice lady in her 50s with a cap and boots on and stuff.
It's the first time for everything, maybe on this tour.
But they're generally nice people, nothing really too strange. I meet all kinds of people after concerts and stuff, but by and large, most people are generally pretty nice, and they come with their albums to be signed, and so nothing really out of the ordinary.
Fantastic. Well, I mean, you're going to be on the road again. You have another tour coming up, and you've got the new single, of course, Can I Leave the Rest to You, which is coming up as well. So you're going to be appearing in London at the Cadogan Hall on the 12th.
Yeah, we're doing that. That's right. So
that's going to be a lovely
venue. I think two years ago we were at the Albert Hall. So this time this is the second stage of a UK tour. The first part was a few months ago. So this is kind of like the second stage. And it ties in nicely with many other things. So I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, so are we. I mean, if people want to find out a little bit more, is there anywhere they should go particularly?
Yeah, I think, well, there's an official site. I've never seen it, but it's but we have people who run the site, and I'm told it's very informative. So I think gildersullivan.com, I'm sure that's all you need to do.
I'm sure it is.
And I think there's Bygum Records is run by my sister. That's where people, if they want to buy original albums and best ofs and stuff, they can get on the Bygum site. So all that kind of stuff's online for people who are interested.
Excellent. I'm sure everyone's going to go to that and look at the Bygum stuff. It sounds fantastic. It just remains for me to say, time has gone very quickly, but thank you very much, Gilbert O'Sullivan, for being on the show.
Nice talking to you.
I wish you all the best with the tour and the new single.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
And that was Gilbert O'Sullivan, and he's on tour with songs from the album Gilbertville.
might see the day when murder would become so commonplace. Hardly a minute ever goes by without a murder taking place. And why? Well, for a start, the punishment's not hard. They sentence you to life, but you're out.
From the album Gilbertville. And in the murder mood, we are indeed, because after the break, there'll be more murder, courtesy of my next guest composer, Richard Rodney Bennett. Well, Murder on the Orient Express, to be precise.
Hello, my name's Cliff Rees-Jones, and you're listening to Suzanne Hunter's World of Arts and Entertainment.
Have you ever wanted to discover more about your local history and mysteries of the area? Then visit Elmbridge Museum in Weybridge. With absorbing exhibitions as well as exciting activities for the whole family, Elmbridge Museum offers a fascinating window to the borough's past. For further information on what's on and to find out about our opening hours, call 01932 843 573 or visit elmbridge.gov.uk/museum to discover more. Or pop in and see us. We're above the library in Weybridge Town Centre.
Fantastic. Richard Rodney Bennett there, yes, the man behind that brilliant score, evocative Orient Express, Murder on the Orient Express, The Waltz. And just a reminder, we'll be getting a little Strictly Come Dancing later, talking of dancers, few can beat Fred Astaire. And so Richard Rodney Bennett, the man behind film compositions like Four Weddings and a Funeral and The Billion Dollar Brain, is turning to the Great American Songbook and Irving Berlin. Before we hear a great week, let's hear from Sir Richard Rodney Bennett.
This is Richard Rodney Bennett, Suzanne Hunter's World of Arts and Entertainment.
It's a true delight to welcome Sir Richard Rodney Bennett onto the show. Thank you so much for joining me.
It's a pleasure.
Now, before we talk about your exciting upcoming show, let me take you back a little bit, well, quite a way back, actually, to the source of your musical talent. I believe you were born into a musical family and began composing as a child. Did you have a good ear naturally, and who did you inherit this from, do you think?
Well, my mother was a composer and pianist, and she gave it up, like nice women did in the 30s, I guess. But she went on being a musician, of course, and my father had been was a writer of children's books. So, I mean, it was in my family. And I wasn't regarded as extraordinary. I was